So good evening, everybody, and welcome to episode 12 of Meet the Judge. And tonight we travel to Eastern Europe, to Romania, and meet arguably one of the most popular judges in dogs. His reputation for being honest, his reputation for being extraordinarily good with exhibits and exhibitors, and a very popular judge, and someone who we count in Ireland as a friend. Good evening, Petru.
Good evening, Carl.
How are you?
Good evening, Ireland.
How are you?
I'm fine, thank you.
And tell me,
still
how are
kicking.
You?
Still kicking.
And tell me, how are things in Romania?
It's not so good. They say that it's a second wave, but actually we didn't finish the first one. In my opinion, this is a flowing thing. And today it was a little bit better than yesterday because we had only 1,183 infections declared. And 33 persons deceased, and 400 persons in intensive care.
That's a lot. Well, I suppose you have a big population, though.
It's scary. It's really amazing what's happening. But it's going up, unfortunately, all over Europe, in my opinion.
Yes.
The second, the so-called second wave is coming. And I think it's a consequence of the, I don't know, the holidays, you know?
Yes, yes, we're having the same problem here.
They lose the restrictions for the holidays, and the result is coming now, and probably in September we will have some very scary statistics.
And do you still have restrictions?
Yes, we have. We have restrictions. You have to wear masks in even in public places, even on the street if it's a crowded area. For instance, in the historical center of Bucharest, which is very crowded, a lot of terraces, a lot of bars, you have to wear masks. They advise us to wear mask when it's a crowded place. Inside, inside, indoor, you are obliged to wear it.
And have you dog shows?
Yes, we still have dog shows with restriction, with everything, you know. You should hear Christian shouting at the microphone, wear the mask, keep the distance. He was amazing in Timișoara. We had the show 2 weeks ago, and it was very strict, and you know, police were coming, authorities from this health directions, you know, for health organization, and we had to respect every second, every minute, everything. We've judged with the mask in the rings, all the exhibitors with the mask. And in the main ring, we organized only the best in show. The groups were organized in the breed ring, you know.
All right. That makes sense.
Like in South America. It's a good thing, you know.
Yes. And tell me, do the dogs react to judges wearing a mask?
No.
No?
I don't think so. I don't think so. They react to the smell of alcohol we are using to clean our hands, you know?
It's just a question that people in Ireland ask a lot, or are worried about, that maybe the dogs would be afraid of a judge approaching them with a mask on. But
No. They don't make too much difference, you know?
Okay.
A stranger with mask or without mask is still a stranger for a dog, believe me.
Very true. That's very true. So, Petru, when you were growing up, did you have dogs? Were your parents involved in dogs? Or
no,
how did you get involved?
You know, my case is a special case because I'm coming from an ex-communist country. Mm. I was born in the year when Stalin died, you know? Mm. Few months after Stalin died. Stalin died in 53 in I think in April, and I was born in July.
Okay.
You understand? Then yeah. I catch the period in a communist country where the kennel clubs were not allowed, breeding purebred dogs were considered to be a sort of bourgeois thing, you know, all this stupid mentality. And after in 65, we got one of the worst dictators of the 20th century, Nicolae Ceaușescu. Mm. We started the first kennel club, real kennel club dedicated to purebred dogs, only in 69.
Wow. Then
it was very difficult to have purebred dogs, but we still had, you know, and not so few as expected. But I didn't have, you know, being a child, my parents, I don't have this heritage, you know, that my parents bred this, bred that, and I took this from them, and I got the pleasure to show, to breed, or to do something with purebred dogs. No. My first purebred dog I had in 1974.
Okay. Okay.
And it was not easy to have it, you know.
Uh-huh.
Not easy at all.
And
you needed relatives abroad, you know. Even in ex-communist country like Hungary, like Czech Republic, like Eastern Germany, connections to import some purebred dogs in Romania. However, I can tell you, it was more or less a sort of miracle, you know. Because we had in Romania some stocks in some breeds of very, very high quality.
Mm-hmm.
We had very good fox terrier wild. We had excellent English setters from pure English bred lines, you know,
yes.
Very, very good quality, you know. And we had some Great Danes of good quality, and very popular were the boxers.
Okay. Okay. And what drew you to dogs? What made you decide?
You know, I had a dream as a young man. I had a dream to have a standard poodle.
All right.
It was so impressive for me. And I got it. It was like a miracle, you know. I got it from Eastern Germany, an apricot standard poodle. And after 1 week, my mother told me, "Oh, him or me." And I had to choose, and I choose my mother, of course. I have to give away this dog. I really was, you know, broken to pieces, but I had to do it. And after 1 or 2 months, my mother decided to reimburse me, you know, for this damage actually he made for me. And one day I came from my work, and opening the door, I saw in front of me a woolly little creature in front of me. I said, "What is this?" "A Pekingese," said my mother. "Do you like it?" 3 days, I didn't even look at the creature, you know. And after 3 days, slowly, slowly, I start to accept it, then to love it, then to adore it. And until I will close my eyes, the Pekingese will be the breed which will be in my heart forever.
Okay. And just going back to what you were saying about being communist country, etc., how did show societies and the kennel club, how did they cope with that regime? I mean, was it under cover? Was it hidden?
No. In Romania, it was impossible to be undercover, you know.
Mm.
We had one of the worst secret political police in the world, you know. I think sometimes they were better than KGB. They knew everything, they penetrated everything, they found out everything. You know, I think that even if we say that they were not very human, actually they were human and they couldn't love also dogs, you know. Okay. And many of them, they had dogs. Even Ceausescu had dogs, you know. All the family loved the dogs, you know. Ceausescu had a Saint Bernard and a couple of Labradors. And the daughter of Ceausescu, Zoe, had an English Cocker. And it was like this, you know. And they, I don't know how to say, silently accepted this.
Yes.
You know, it was strange for many people from your part of Europe. It's difficult to understand.
Oh, completely.
It's difficult to understand this. Mm. But to have a dog, it was an adventure, a purebred dog at that time.
So then
but we had it. Imagine, and in the beginning of the 70s, in 74, 77, 78, I started to organize shows, you know, to be a part of the organization of the shows in my town, you know, in Transylvania. And you could see in a show not so many dogs, but some breeds were really extremely popular. The boxers were judging four rings, you know, by sexes and colors. Three rings, you know, schnauzers, giant schnauzers in two rings, males and females. And we had quite excellent stock in this breed. It's interesting, but things were like this. Those were the times.
I remember you saying once while we were on a judging appointment that service in restaurants was terrible.
Yes.
Because, do you want to explain that to everybody?
You expected after order something to get a slap from the waiter.
Because that's the job they always had. They would.
You know, the people pretended to work, but the regime pretended to pay us. This was the slogan at the time.
So when nobody, communism...
It was only fear. Nobody respected anything.
So when communism fell, it must have been a huge freedom in terms of showing dogs and organizing and everything.
Of course, the doors of the world opened for us. You know, imagine so many years being kept in this cage, you know, because we couldn't travel or we couldn't exchange anything. We were completely blocked, you know, inside. It was very difficult to be a dog person, a purebred dog person, and try to breed and to do something. It was really an adventure and in the end a miracle to get a dog from abroad, you know. Then it was really, really difficult to do it. But we survived, as you see.
Yes.
We are here.
You're a survivor. Somebody is just asking a question here on Facebook. Outside of dogs, what are your interests?
Outside of dogs in this moment.
I know you speak.
Because I have many
how many languages do you speak?
Six to eight, but four I speak, I control. And the rest I only whistle, you know. No, I don't like to do things I cannot control 100%, you know. And I speak 4 to 5 languages quite well, and I can write and read and everything, you know, translate, and I can judge. My ambition was to judge in all 4 official FCI languages, and I tried my best to do it. And I can do it, you know. Extra, I can judge in Hungarian. I can judge because I'm from Transylvania, you know. Transylvania is a multicultural place. Yes. We have 3 main nations who composed, actually, historically, the population of Transylvania. First, the Romanians, Hungarians, and Germans, you know. Right. Hungarians came in 1000 in Transylvania, and the German colonies came in 12th century in Transylvania. Mm-hmm. Then, you know, it's a multicultural place. Mm-hmm. And being a child on the street, you couldn't learn from your friend, you know, oh, Hungarian or German, some words like this. But after starting judging a little bit more abroad, I realized that it's very important for me to adapt myself to the conditions, you know.
Yes.
For example, one time I was in Moscow and I didn't have interpreter, I didn't have translator, and I had to judge in Russian. I never studied in my life 1 second of Russian in school. I was a first generation not to be obliged to study Russian, you know.
Okay.
I studied English and French. And Italian I learn, I also can judge also very good in Italian. I learned by myself because Romanian and Italian are quite close languages, really? Latin languages.
Yes, yeah. So then you started in Pekingese.
It's a way of saying I had only one Pekingese in my life, but it's the first and the last for me.
Okay.
I would like to have them. It's amazing breed for me. It's absolutely amazing breed, but I don't have time, I don't have patience, and I don't have enough time in front of me to do it.
Okay. So leaving the poodle then aside, what breed did you really start winning with and breeding?
Yes, after the poodle, I had this Pekingese which died in my house, and I never produced, I never was a special exhibitor, or I didn't follow quite well. I get involved in the dog world mostly organizing shows, you know, and helping in the shows and promoting the breeds in Romania. Mm-hmm. Because from 86, from 77, no, sorry, from 82, I became a member of the local kennel club.
Right.
And then in 87, I became president of my local kennel club. And in 87, I was elected also in the board of the Romanian Kennel Club. And I never quit this position until this moment.
Really?
Okay. And this was my evolution. In the beginning of the 80s, I got my first dachshund. I wanted a dachshund, and I got a standard smooth dachshund.
Okay.
And from that moment until now, I have only, as a breeder, I bred only smooth dachshund.
Right.
Under the affix of Dacia Aurea. Mm-hmm. Dacia is the ancient Romania, you know, name of Romania. And Aurea means golden. Golden Dacia, you know.
Yeah. And when you started, who were the people that influenced you most?
It's difficult to say. I had many, many persons who, but I had mostly two Romanian kinologues, and at the time they were judges. Mm-hmm. It was a man from Bucharest who unfortunately died some years ago at 90, I think he was 97. His name was Ilinca Gheorghe. He was a fantastic person, a simple man, but so much dedicated with a huge knowledge about dogs and a fantastic intuition, you know. He was looking to a dog and he said, this dog, it's fantastic, can go with this female, you know. He had this, you know, instinct, natural instinct for breeding, you know. And I think that in the dog world, this natural instinct is making miracles more than breeding. He was amazing. And the second was Gleb Padnevich, who for a long period was involved in the leadership of the Romanian Kennel Club, who was, I don't know, he was not teaching me, but he was giving me some guidelines, you know.
It is very important.
Very, very important. And at the time, we had some very, very good judges, but nobody knew them because they couldn't go out.
So when did you...
Going back now with my experience, I think that they were really amazing for the conditions where they were living and the condition. They were really gifted for this, you know.
And when did you first start judging?
I started to judge in 91.
91?
Yes. Okay. And they pushed me to go to give the exams. I didn't want to become a judge. But they pushed me. They said, you have to go, you have to go, you have to go. And I did it.
And you haven't looked back. And what was the best piece of advice they gave you?
Oh?
The people that were pushing you.
I don't know. The people who pushed me, I think they were not really kinologue. They were more managers, you know?
Okay.
Yeah. And, you know, probably they had this intuition that I am capable to do this.
And
it was a pure luck, you know?
No, luck has nothing to do with it.
I didn't have any ambitions, you know.
And do you think...
And I don't have ambitions even now, you know.
And do you think it's important for new judges to talk to and ask questions of breeders and experienced judges and get advice from them?
I think it's essential. I have a say, in the dog world, breeder or judge, the visual culture, it's essential. More you see, more you understand. More you ask, more you understand. You have to be humble and modest and to have the courage and to have the, I don't know, the honesty to admit that you don't know so well this or you don't know at all. And I have to ask and to put it in my mind, you know. For instance, in the Russian breeds, I don't consider myself to be a specialist, but I really, without false modesty, I tell you that I really learned very well this breed. Because every time I was going in the 90s and the beginning of 20s in Russia, I was asking everywhere I was to get in contact with a breeder, you know. Chorny Terrier, Black Russian Terrier, of Central Asian Shepherd, of Caucasian Shepherd, of Borzoi, and to talk and to try to understand the breed, you know? It's no other way you can understand deeply You're quite right.
And you can read the standard 10 times, but you need to talk
the
to
the visual culture and the communication is very important.
Yeah.
To pick an information from here, to pick an information from there. It's very, very important. And you must not be, I don't know, too presumptuous, you know. You must be humble, and if a person is stopping to learn, he's dead, in my opinion.
Oh, absolutely. I've said, this is something we say in most of our interviews, that even as all-rounders, you never stop learning. And if you do, then you should stop judging.
I think an all-rounder must learn more 100 times than anybody else, you know.
Yeah.
You cannot go in a ring and make a fool of yourself. If somebody thinks that to be all-rounder is enough, no. Brothers and sisters, all-rounders is not enough. Study, study, study.
This and is what advice would you give new judges?
To go and see. Visual culture, as I said, it's essential in dogs, because an 8 years old boy can recite a standard, but he cannot judge the breed. You have to see, you have to compare, you have to analyze, you have to talk to this, to that, to a breeder, to a judge, a colleague judge, to a specialist in the breed. Okay, I am a little bit suspicious about this term of specialist, because FCI didn't establish a statute for this label of specialist, but everybody is using it. I found myself to be a specialist in toys. Who the fuck? Sorry, who made me specialist in toys? Nobody. The people around the ring or the breeders. Okay, I believe in and I trust, and I'm really honored to be called by this breeder specialist. But officially, I'm not a specialist in anything.
Yeah.
I'm specialist in everything being all-rounder, but not in a special breed.
Yeah.
Being a breeder of a breed, you know, a purebred dog breed, does not mean absolutely that you are a specialist in the breed. You have to prove it.
Yes. Yeah. Great.
This is my opinion. Then I think that FCI should think about giving this title of breed specialist in a very official and in an official frame of conditions.
Yes.
For judges.
It's a very good idea.
My opinion. I think like this.
And how many countries have you judged in now?
Nearly 60.
60.
Wow. I don't like statistics.
That's taking you around the world.
I don't like to go to do blood tests, and I don't like statistics, you know? Because going to do blood tests, they will tell me, don't eat this, don't smoke, don't drink, don't do this, don't do that. No, no. And statistics are telling me that you had too much or you didn't do too much in your life, you know? Then I don't like this.
Okay, well, we'll move on then. Aside from your own breed, what is your favorite breed to judge?
For all rounder, it's very dangerous to say I like this or I like that. Everybody's saying, oh, I like to judge all the breeds. It's normal to say like this, because you are obliged to protect your portfolio, you know, as an all rounder. As an all rounder, you must be equal to every breed, which is more or less impossible, to be honest. Mm-hmm. But I like to judge some groups mostly.
Okay.
I'm not saying in the order of my my preferences.
Okay.
It's first, second, fourth, because it's, what can I say about that?
Yes.
I love that. I breathe.
Okay. Yeah. Fair enough.
Toys. 9 and 10. Cycles.
Okay.
I really enjoy, but I cannot deny I like very much terriers. I like group 5. I like this hunting dog from group 6 a lot because they are one of the most, I don't know how to say, preserving the nativity, the originality of the hunting dog, you know, nowadays. They are more or less close to the primitive type of dogs. And this I like very much. This closeness to the nature is a joy for me in dogs.
Okay. Always. Okay, fair enough. And what fault really irritates you?
Faults in dogs?
What fault in a dog, it really irritates you.
The lack of character, the temperament.
Okay.
I hate it. If a dog has no character, is coming and is staying like an autist in my ring, for me is zero.
Okay. Yeah. And we know you speak several languages. So when you're critiquing, how do you approach it? How do you go about critiquing? And do you think they're valuable?
I do the critique, you know, when you have 80, 100, 120 dogs, you cannot make novels, you know,
absolutely
describing a dog. But always in my mind, it was one idea. When I read, when a person, without knowing too much about dogs, is reading a critique, more or less, he must have in front of him the sketch of the dog I have judged.
That is the best.
With the good parts and also the bad parts, you know, justifying my decision. It's excellent, it's very good, it's good, it's satisfactory, it's disqualified.
That's one of the best descriptions I've heard.
Must be like a sketch, like a blurred photo, you know, because even the standard and even my description cannot be so accurate. And they are not. I'm in the standard commission of FCI. The standard, it's only a sketch picturing the ideal shape of a dog, but giving some space, you know, to compose the frame of the dog, you know, and to place him being excellent, very good, good, or so on, you know.
And do you think critiques are valuable?
Yes, extremely. And I have to make a parenthesis here. I don't want to offend anybody. But the dog world went on a wrong way, in my opinion. Because, you know, we have the handlers, which are professionals. We claim to be amateurs. Even if we are not, it's a big lie, in my opinion. We have to rethink and to replace in a different frame our dog world. But this is not my job.
Yeah,
it's other people's job in this moment. But I can tell you that we are not in the right place in this moment.
No, we will touch on that later.
Yes, probably. Okay. Thank you.
And CK. And
listen. Yes. I have to finish this. In my opinion, the critique is the only message, me, judge, I have the opportunity to give to the breeder. This means you do a good job, a less good job, not at all, then you have to do something else. The handler is coming between like a short circuit, you know. The handler, it's for this, you know. Then he can tell if I put only X's, you know, on the page. He can tell whatever he wants to his client. He can say that the judge was stupid, the judge was blind, the judge was corrupted, or all three together, you know. You understand what I mean? To preserve the client, because the client is giving him money, is giving him some bread to eat. I'm not blaming anybody. Please do understand. I like to have an excellent handler in my ring, showing perfectly a dog, and in 2 minutes, in 1 minute, I decide myself, this is excellent, this is get the ticket, this is the best of breed, or so on. You understand?
Yeah.
It's easy for me than to have an amateur not being able to put in value an excellent quality dog, which is getting on my nerves, actually. But this is it. You have to take it like it is.
Yes.
I believe that critique, it's essential.
And CKs or CQs, do you think they are valuable?
Excellent.
Do you have it in Romania?
Not yet, yeah. But I intend to promote this. Why? Because I believe in the existence of the mediocre excellent and the champion quality excellent.
Yeah.
I believe in this.
I agree.
These nuances does exist. You can have an excellent dog in front of you, but it's not giving me any, the dogs totally which are giving you goosebumps. I want to see this dog. That dog is CQ dog. It's a champion quality dog. This is dog can win everywhere. This is the meaning of a CQ, and I believe in CQ. Really.
Good. And how do you you mentioned exhibitors who don't often handle their dogs terribly well, but how do you deal with irate exhibitors or exhibitors who don't accept your decision?
Yes, I did. There's everybody. They are everywhere. No, what is irritating me is that they pretend to know better the standard than I do. This is the only thing it's irritating me, because for sure they don't have my experience. But I'm not in... I'm a humble person. If I make a mistake, I can reconsider my decision. And people must understand, we are not gods judging dogs. We are equals, you know?
Yes. Yeah.
You come to propose and I dispose. This is our position in that moment, you know? But we are equal, because both of us, we are competing for the future of the breed. And our interest is to promote good dogs and to promote and to give a good future for the breeds. Then if we think like this, we cannot make too many mistakes and everybody will be happy in the end.
But
I try to hold my horses, even if a person is rude and uneducated, which is quite often you can find this kind of persons in the dog world.
But do you think, when you're talking about the promoting breeds, etc., do you think judges understand the role they have in developing breeds or influencing breeds? or telling breeds you're not necessarily going in the right direction. Do you think judges understand that?
I think many of them, they does, fortunately. Mm. It's very important to understand that all this dog dome is relying on two pylons, the breeder and the judge. Mm. These are the two factors influencing the future of the dog world.
Yeah. And
the responsibilities are important. But in the end, in my opinion, the judge is the ultimate responsible for the future and the evolution of the breed. Because an exhibitor can bring you whatever he wants in your ring with his paint.
Very
and bringing you whatever he wants. You can find yourself in a front, I'm repeating myself maybe, in the front of a camel in a class, you know, because the organizer didn't pay too much attention, you know, at the inscriptions, you know, or I don't know, the exhibitor wants to put you in a difficult situation or he wants to make a bad joke. But you can find in front of a goat or a camel in your ring, what are you doing? You have to decide. Which is which and who is who. I have seen so many world champions, European champions, mega galactic champions, whatever you want, who never produce a good quality dog. But this is not connected with the decision of the judge.
Yeah.
Because the judge could have put the best he had in ring in that moment. But when he put a bad example of the breed, and this dog, 1 year, 2 years, is mating all the bitches all over the world because he's world champion. It's a tragedy, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Because yeah. He's producing in geometrical extension bad dogs.
Mm-hmm.
Bad dogs. Then we have to pay attention to this very much. We are very much responsible of the future of the breed.
Okay.
I don't dare to say that we are the unique responsibles.
No, maybe not. Mm. And what's your biggest judging achievement so far?
My biggest judging achievement?
Achievement.
You know, I wish to everybody in my position to judge a best in show at European Dog Show. Mm. I had this opportunity. It was the maximum I got. And I am very grateful to the Romanian Kennel Club and I'm very grateful to the dog world that I have this opportunity. I don't think that I did the best work or the worst work. But for me, it was the maximum possible. It was for me a unique opportunity to judge such a high level best in show.
Yes, and a fabulous honor from your own country. And who are your heroes in dogs, past or present?
The world is full of heroes. Unfortunately, they are not alive anymore. We have some alive, but I don't want to pump, you know. I have some persons I really, really respected in the dog world for their knowledge, for what they have achieved and everything. I don't want to give names.
Okay.
It's unfair. It's unfair. I have some favorites, of course.
No, that's fair enough. We shall move on.
Happily, luckily, we have names.
This is true.
We have names.
We do. So you are, as you said, very active within the Romanian Kennel Club. A former board member. I think you're no longer a board member, is that right?
I am a vice president of the Romanian Kennel Club.
Oh, okay. Apologies. How important do you think it is for Dubh people to give something back to their sport by way of organization or club membership or involvement in their breed?
In my opinion, it's essential. We are living very strange times, you know. God have been replaced with 100 euro bill, you know. Everything is turning around this new God. If you don't pay, you don't get services. If you don't pay, nobody's helping you. It's very important to dedicate yourself to something. To something.
Yeah.
In my opinion, it's essential to be a part of something in nowadays. Life is becoming more and more virtual, you know?
Yeah.
Everybody got, I don't know, an escape in this virtual world. But we have to go back to reality sometimes.
Mm-hmm.
And reality, it's how it is.
So tell us about the famous Dracula show that you are involved in, probably started. So how did that come about?
This is a very funny story. I was judging in 97 or 98 in Belgrade. And my friend, Dr. Milivoj Urošević, was a part of the organization and doing the microphone. He was the MC of the show. And I was supposed to judge Group 9. And he introduced me like this. And now from Romania, Mr. Draculescu. And in that moment, I became instantly red. You know, I was a little bit nervous. I went, I judged the group. I came back to the judges' table. I sit down. And after 2 minutes, I cool down and I say, oops, this is not a bad idea. And from here came the idea of the Dracula Dog Show. And I went back to Romania. And I tried hardly with the previous board of the Kennel Club. I was president at that time. But I did. The board was not very friendly with me because I was, I don't know, a little bit too in front of them, you know. They couldn't catch me up. It's difficult to understand for you because, you know, we are dealing with mentalities of the past, you know, and I was one step forward and I wanted to integrate Romania in this kinological international family by any means. And maybe I got a little bit too much speed for them, you know, and they couldn't understand me. And this was the reason I got the second vote to be president, the second turn. In 2000, and I resigned because I was not able to collaborate with the members of the board. And in 2005, when it was a sort of so-called revolution in the Romanian Kennel Club and Christian became president, things changed. And then I went to Christian and I said, I want to organize this Dracula show. It will be good for Romania. It's a good label. And he said, okay, but where? And I said, Târgu Mureș, because from years and years they were organizing the shows in Târgu Mureș in a fortress. Medieval fortress. And the ambience, the atmosphere was appropriate to this kind of show. To go to the Middle East, to the might of Dracula, Count Dracula, and so on, Vlad Țepeș, everything was connected, you know, Transylvania, everything fitted, you know. And with the help of your Irish fabulous writer, Bram Stoker, we built one of the most, I don't know how to say, not famous, but well-known shows all over the world.
And it's quite big. It's quite a big show now, isn't it?
No, it's not a big show. It's a show of quality, not a show of quantity. Because it's collecting top dogs from all over the world. It's amazing to have 30, 35 nations present every bloody show in this show in Transylvania. It's amazing. And dogs of very, very good quality. Because not everybody can travel. We don't have so many highways. The access is not so easy. Okay, I can understand this. But really, the show, it's giving atmosphere and it's rejoicing the participation of so many nations and so great dogs. I'm judging since the first edition. This year will be the 15th edition of the Dracula. I'm judging the best in show because, okay, inside gratitude for giving them on a silver plate such an idea. And I had fantastic best in show lines nearly every year. Top quality dogs.
That's very good. So we're going to move on to a more serious topic now. I do know you love French bulldogs. How do you think Kennel clubs are dealing with this issue? And how do we, as a judge and a lover of our sport, how are we going to protect ourselves against these laws, activists, whatever you want to call?
It's a very hot potato. In my opinion, what's happening, we should have expected this from many years. I'm very sorry to say that since 2011, it was a European section meeting in Leeuwarden where they held the European Dog Show in Holland. I stand up and I told them that be careful. Animalists infiltrated in the dog world. I had this smell, you know, this feeling. They have been infiltrated, their agents in the dog world, and they are digging. They are digging about many, many subjects. They started with cropping and docking, no spray, no table, no leashes, not that. Dogs on the stress being in cages and so on and so on. I had the feeling that they were acting after a program. And now I realize that for sure they had a program.
Yeah.
Very well organized, reaching the targets like this. FCI did nothing, was only in defensive. They said, no cropping, no docking. Okay, we are not cropping or not docking. No spray, no table, no, we are not doing this anymore. Fuck off, please. This is a different thing. The domestic dog, the purebred dog, is not a savage animal. Don't apply to the domestic animals the rules of the savage animals because they are not comparable. They are not.
Yeah.
You cannot feed them in the same frame. It's impossible. And to try now, after so many years, 10,000 years, or maybe more, to undomesticate, I don't know if it's correct in English, a domesticated animal, for me, is completely stupid. Completely it's absurd, you know.
And you know,
but FCI didn't react.
But no kind of
offensive, no offensive, nothing. We just say we don't want to do this because, and arguments shouldn't be given.
Yeah,
we have arguments, but we give the arguments too late now.
But none of the big
my opinion, what's happening in Holland, it's a part of a program. Please don't consider myself a paranoiac or I don't know, out of my mind. But I think seriously that it's a program of kicking out from the human life the pets, not only the dogs, all the pets. But as long as the dogs are the large majority, are composing the largest majority of pets in the world, more than 2 billion, maybe more in this moment.
Yes.
This is the problem. From 72, this food organization, FAO, started to scream that the humankind, we are too many and we don't have enough food. Think about this. Yeah. And continents. Think about Africa, think about half Asia, think about South America, starving. People, humans, starving. Then we are giving food to these pets, 2 billion or more, and we are leaving the people to starve and to die from starvation. This is logical. Probably I went a little bit too up with my thinking, but the cause must exist. The dog has been one of the first animals domesticated by the humans, and they, beside the horse, they were the best companions of the humans during all the history, you know.
Yes.
Working for us, you know.
Yeah. And you know,
why in this moment we want to kick them out? This is a big question, in my opinion.
But none of the kennel clubs are standing up and saying this is wrong. You know, not only FCI, but across the world. And I think this is the issue.
The issue is that they don't realize what's happening. And many of them, they say, oh, they cannot touch us, which is not true. Which is not true.
Mm.
It's like the virus, you know.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
They said, oh, it's only in China. And then slowly, slowly, they made damages more in Europe than they did in the country of origin of the virus, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And you never know.
And do you know, I was only looking at photographs of French bulldogs on the internet last night, going back 150 years when King Edward VII had French bulldogs, and they were no different to what they are now. No different.
No. You know, what is absurd for me is that these breeds are same from 100, 200 years. They are still in front of us because they are much older than 200 years than have.
Absolutely, yes.
Somebody, the British did, because the British is the standard for many, many of this kind of breeds, Asian breeds. We know this. They brought the breeds in Europe. They worked on them. They provided the standard and everything. Okay, chapeau. Mm. But if they are still here, they are survivors.
Mm.
It's not a breed meant to die because it's sick.
Mm.
A sick breed will disappear.
Mm. Yeah. You're quite
agreed
right.
With, I don't know, biological force will survive. Mm. And they are still here. Pugs, Bostons, Pekingese, Japanese chins, French bulldogs, they are here from hundreds of years. What they are telling me, this professor from University of Utrecht, they are brainwashing all the, these animals, they are brainwashing all the veterinarians in all congresses all over the world. And FCI is nowhere coming and saying, no, it's not true. Look, veterinarians, to this dog. You understand what I mean? I expected from years a reaction of, I am also FCI, you are FCI, we are all FCI. We have to wake up and to fight for our breeds because they are national, historical, natural, and cultural treasures of humanity.
Yeah.
We are responsible to preserve this. We have to feel, all of us, this responsibility.
Mm-hmm.
This is what I think.
So where do you see our sport in 10 years?
It's difficult to say.
I'm just going to disappear. You keep talking there. Just bear with, keep talking.
It's difficult to say why, because in my opinion, we didn't do two very important things. We didn't promote our dog world, purebred dog world.
Mm-hmm.
We lost the interface with society.
Mm-hmm.
We are living in a parallel universe, and we don't have political lobby.
Yes,
FCI
thank you.
Does not have political lobby at all.
And we need it.
We needed this from years.
And Michael Forte said this.
We are at the ultimate shore, in my opinion, in this moment. You asked me how I see the dog world in 10 years. I wish to see it bright, but I still have my doubts in this moment.
Well, that's interesting now, because that's interesting you said that, because Michael Forte said the exact same thing last week, that FCI and Kennel Club London need to get a committee together, not of necessarily dog people, but of experts that are going to go to Europe and say, no, we are not the enemy here. Puppy farmers, yes, they are the enemy, but we are not.
By contrary, Cole, we are not enemies. We are the, I don't know,
preserver.
How to say, the preservers of a treasure, human, of humanity.
Mm.
And they are attacking exactly this. Mm. You know, the theory of the animalist is, okay, don't breed anymore, and they try hardly to kill the breeding, as you see. No more bred dogs. Adopt dogs from shelters, which are sterilized. In 50 years, the dogs will disappear as species on the earth. Easily, just like this.
Yeah.
This is a theory. And for me, it's obvious that don't breed, sterilize the other ones, and it's finished.
Mm. Yeah, you're quite right. Okay.
So it's very logical, in my opinion, unfortunately.
So we're going to lighten the mood now a little bit. What is the funniest moment, almost embarrassing, that you've had as a judge in a ring?
No, I didn't have the only one, you know. I was in Moscow many years ago. It was in the end of the 90s. And I was judging English bulldogs. And a beautiful lady came to my ring with an English bulldog. I've judged a dog and I give very good. nervous. She went out of the ring, and from outside of the ring, she shouted at me, "You." And in a fraction of second, I said, I have to go out of this situation. And I shouted, "When and where, please?" It's a little bit vulgar, but it's happening, you know.
Yeah, yeah. So, if you couldn't live in Romania, what country would you like to live in?
It's difficult to say. I like Italy, I like Portugal a lot. I can live in both of these, in south of Italy for sure, in Sicily, or in Sardinia, I would like, or in Portugal. Portugal, it's an amazing country. I love it.
Okay.
You know, we are the extreme of Latinity. We Romanians, we are like a sort of Latin island in a Slavian ocean here in Eastern Europe. Portuguese are the extreme, the last extreme of Latinity in Western Europe. But we are very, I don't know how to say, we are very similar in many ways.
Okay.
Many
That's ways. Interesting.
Many ways. And I like the spirit, I like the people, I like the food, it's fabulous. And if I say that I love sea, then for me, Mediterranean, all the countries around Mediterranean are the best countries in the world, because it's on my soul, you know, it's applying to my spirituality.
Okay. And finally, Petru, if you could write your epitaph, what would it be?
What can say Dracula? I'll meet you at midnight.
I like it. Petru, it's been brilliant. Thank you very much. You've been very honest.
Thank you. I'm always honest. I have so less in front that I have behind. It's no use to lie, to be hypocrite. Doesn't serve anything. Being yourself. In life, you must be yourself. Deliver, free yourself, and be as you are.
Well, thank you very much for talking to us, and stay safe.
It was a pleasure, Colm.
Stay
you
safe.
You are an excellent host.
I have to do nothing but listen.
All the best to all my Irish friends, to you, your family, Rita, and I think we can
meet again, hopefully.
Hopefully.
And Rita particularly says hello.
Ciao. All the
good night.
Good night.
Good night.
Ciao.